I'll speak to you about what we have observed that happens with Psaltiki after the invention of the internet, practically. When I speak of digital world, I'm not speaking about the CDs, I'm speaking about the last years, the years after 2005 maybe, where we have fast internet connections, we have plenty of stored space in internet, so practically we have a new type of communication. So the main question I'm posing is how the new technologies will are affecting already the evolution of Psaltiki. Permit me to use this Greek word, Psaltiki. I don't want to have it as Psaltic art or chanting art. It's Psaltiki by definition. And so the sub-question will be if we can trace the older past, if we can trace the changes that came because of the modern world to our perceptions of Psaltiki. So, I have a very brief map. We speak of pre-modern era till the time that we have the Enlightenment, the Industrial Revolution, and mainly the nation states. For Psaltiki especially, I have to mention two chronologies. One is 1820, when the first printed books of Parasimandiki emerged, and the other one is 1911, where we have the first gramophone records. I think that these two days are very important for the evolution. And so practically after the 2000s, as I told you, we have the online communities, and one you all of you know already is the Psaltologion. You are familiar with it, I hope. Or maybe even Symvoli, which is Mr. Anatoly Kyoti's work, is also such a kind, but Psaltologion is a better example because it gives another way of thinking. And also, after 2000s, we have the exchange of archives as a very common means in music. Music is circulated through the web, and it's not circulated as a material object, but it's just information. These topics have been already been researched by anthropology, and we have a general study of communications and of music. So I'm based on what is being done already on these topics, and I try to apply them in the study of Psaltiki. So I will concentrate only in three topics, and I will not exhaust them. I cannot do it in 20 minutes. One question is the recordings of sound. The other question is, the other topic is the written information and the notation. And the third question is the socializing through the web, like the online communities. Is it clear when I speak of online communities, what do I mean? Huh? Okay. So, as I started telling you, there are some main features of the digital era. The first question is that information is disengaged from the material carrier. I can read the book without having it in my hands. It's a constant problem, especially if you are studying manuscripts, that you need the manuscript. So 50 years ago, we had the photocopy, the microfilms. Now, we have digital copies which travel much easier and so on. What is important in this case is that now we have a big ease of access and the minimization of cost. While at that time, in the 60s or in the 70s, Mr. Stathis can tell you in details how hard it was to go and find the manuscript in Mount Athos and write down that this is that manuscript, and that's why we speak of a monumental work about his research. Now it's becoming easier and easier to find this old material. Practically, we have a monstrous abundance of information now. I want to underline this word, it's monstrous already, and it will become much bigger in the years that are coming. We have a huge number of contacts also because of this digital world. Actually, even many of us, we have already communicated a lot before coming here just through the web, and practically I can say for myself that I have many digital friends which I rarely meet, but we exchange informations and so on. And what Petridis, who did doctorate research about it last years for the University of Athens, said, there is not only these communities become a place of exchange. I mean, I have a recording, I have a CD maybe, I can upload for you in the web and you can download it and listen to it. But in the case of Psaltiki, it's not the published CD anymore. What is important is that we are not exchanging published CDs, we exchange amateur recordings. So let me, I will come to this topic in 5 minutes. One question that is very essential, and I will not answer it, just I give it you as a question, is who has access to the internet? It's a very obvious question because the younger generation like us, we have an access, but the older generation, like Mr. Neralgis, for example, would be a good example. Mr. Haji Theodoro is young yet. So many of the older Shanters and the older researchers have no contact. So practically their knowledge is disseminated to the internet through their students. But it is a more complicated process. Okay. So one important issue given all this is the minimization of cost. And it is important because you can see it in the evolution of a recording industry. It's for recording industry, it's becoming a problem because of the exchange of archives, the recording companies cannot have a profit. But for Psaltiki, it's completely the opposite because few people have profits out of publishing recordings of Psaltiki, and you know it very well. So getting rid of the cost, it's a great profit for us. Because practically the discography of Psaltiki was always in the margins of commerce. It was not a really commercial procedure. So, you know, I look to Mr. Stathis once again, how hard it was to raise the money in order to make a publication in the 80s. So now there is no such, gradually the question is becoming less important. You don't need any money to publish the recording you made in a church. And also, anyway, this making a recording and processing the sound a little bit or the image, it's easier and easier. So in music, out of these procedures, out of these evolutions, we have a boom of amateur creation, what is called mashup in musical jargon, like cutting pieces from different recordings and assembling them together. By the way, this process, maybe it's very close to what happened to the old folk music. Just in old times, this was not done by technological means, but it was done by speech, by very simple means. But what we have it, we know very well this example in folk music, that one takes one phrase from here, one phrase from there, and reassembles a new thing, which is his. The same happens with new technologies in these mashup and remix communities. Especially in Psaltiki, instead of having amateur creation, it seems that we have a development of amateur ethnography. People who are fond of some particular shanters go make a recording and then give them to their other friends in the online community. And I say again that Psaltologion, it is this address, is a very lively such community. There is an exchange of many recordings and so on. This also means one more aspect, that in the modern era, because of the gramophone and the printing industry, we have a clear distinction between the provider and the receiver. In order to enter the printing industry, like making a book or making a record, a vinyl record or a CD, you needed money, you needed to be close to the center of decisions and so on. And because of this, in the modern world, we have this form that one is talking, one is writing, and many read him, many listen to him. It is the model of the radio. I think it's very clear. In the digital era, this is changing. We have a relationship of exchange. I give you something, you give me something, we are in the same level, more or less. That's why these networks are called peer-to-peer networks. Or in Greek, it's a very nice word, omotima dictia. Dictia networks where all people are on the same level, practically. This means that level of participation increases with the digital era. This is an essential difference compared to the modern era. One more question is that in the modern era, the main centers become more and more powerful. And this is because also of the movement of population. For example, Athens in the beginning of 19th century is a small town, about 10,000 people, maybe even less. In the middle 60s, is about 2 or 3 million. So the regional Greece is bleeding to Athens, and Athens become bigger and bigger. While in the pre-modern era, it seems that there were many smaller centers, of course, with a local capability of local radiation, how to say it. And so we have these kind of micro-traditions which gradually disappear in the modern era. And of course, we must mention here that for now we have a different scale. Because at pre-modern times, the communication was bound by physical boundaries, and it was inside a restricted geographical region, while now we're communicated no matter where you are. So Benedict Anderson also spoke about this in his monumental book about imagined communities, how the printing industry affected the creation of nation states. The nation state means one common language in order to communicate. That's why we have the official form of the languages, and which is supported by the printing industry. Before it, we have no such case. I mean, actually, the Cretan variant of Greek, or the Epirotic kind of variant of Greek, the dialect, is equally important, as well as the Greek of the Constantinople or of Athens. Now, already Athens has become the main center. So excuse me, I go faster because we don't have so much time. One question I wanted to... Okay, I must be faster. One question I wanted to pose is if the new method of writing the Byzantine music is somehow affected by this change. I mean, it's not that they just thought about it. They had the problem already that the printing industry was coming, and they needed to fix that. We will write this movement with that sign. So, okay, this is for you that you deal with the older systems. Recapitulating, we have new features for the recordings that now they are disseminated through the web. First of all, they are available instantly and everywhere. Then they are constantly available because it's so easy to reproduce them without any loss, which was not the case even with the cassette tapes. In the cassette tapes, if you made many copies, it was a big problem. Third, they are free of charge because they cost nothing practically. And fourth, which is very important, I think, here, they are open to discussion and improvement. If you have a tape, you just have the sound. Now, in the internet, you have gradually this discussion that this is the tape of Thrasivoulos Stanitsas, for example, made in 51 and not 65 in that church or that church. He was still in Constantinople. No, he came to Athens. So all these details are gradually are connected, all this metadata, which, of course, in recordings are equally precious as they are for manuscripts. And Mr. Siachos yesterday spoke about such details, and of course you have done all this work, so you know about it. And also it's important to know here that especially with the online forums and the online communities, this information is accumulated. I mean, somebody knows something today, he puts it there. After 1 year, somebody can find some other information. He puts it there. So gradually, we know more and more, and more precisely, we know. So all these features were not existing in the older forms of discography, on the material discography. In the material discography, you had the record. What information was there? It was there, and then it was published and disseminated. And thanks to Mr. Stathis, we have some records with good quantity of information. But the records published by Zoe 12 years earlier have no information at all. So just what you hear. And if you want to have some objection, you must try to say it. On the contrary, and that's one of the points I wanted to underline again, is that manuscripts were much more open as a form in the pre-modern era. If you had a manuscript, maybe you could add something if you wish, some notes that I perform it like that. This is the manuscript. While on the book, you have what is printed, and then you have the additions. So it's a different case. So in the digital era, because of all this, first of all, it's important to notice that we have a resurfacing of the recordings of the older discography. For example, the recordings of Nafpliotis or of Maneas, which were done in the 20s or in the 30s, now are available, while for many years they were not existing practically. They had disappeared. They are available for study, for research, for questioning why Nafpliotis sang like that or like that. And the online community is very suitable place for discussion. That I know somebody who knew Nafpliotis and he was telling this. No, I know something else. So we can research and talk about it. The next question, which is exactly what we said, the most important, is that we have a kind of publication of an unpublished material, which is a peculiar material. First of all, it is raw material. It is recorded mainly in churches. And gradually, the field recording, this simple fact that it is recorded in the church and not in a studio, it's becoming a value, which is something we had missed in the era of the vinyl or even of the shellacs, where it was done especially for the recording. Now we're coming back to the natural space of chanting, of psaltiki, where, and maybe we have also some recordings from mathemata, from lessons, where it's also another case where the teacher explains, I sing it like that, it's not like that, and so on. Also, it's important to understand here that we're coming back to the notion of community, because we don't have this question of producer and listener, but they are coming much closer. That the listener becomes the producer of something else. The producer is the chanter because he's also a chanter, and so it's a much more interconnected world. A third question is that it is an open form, and there is no limit, there is no clear limit between what is official and what is unofficial. Because in the 20th century, we have this question of officiality and originality very strong. So practically here, we come to the fact that we have new criteria, both of evaluation of the recordings. I mean, in the 20s or in the 30s, there was this question that this recording is not clear enough or something like that, or it's not accurate to the manuscript. But now we come to the question that it is original. It is exactly as it was performed in the church, maybe with mistakes, of course, but it is really what happened. And if you take and make comparisons, how are the people are singing in the church? So some features that were imposed practically by modernity, like this question of having a clear recording, gradually they are left off. And so we're coming back to some more functional variants of psaltiki, of what exactly happens inside the church, which is very important. So here we see that we we have an abundance of sources of psaltiki. We have a big number of choices also. It's not like in older times when it was very difficult to find a good chanter. You had to travel, for example, to Constantinople or to Athos to find a good chanter. Here you can hear him from your desktop. Of course, this makes another question that practically now the big chanters like Karamanis, let's say an example, or Stanitsas maybe, or Angelopoulos, who one you want, they are known to everybody. This comes even from the modern era, actually. It's not a feature of the digital era. So they are well known, and you can listen to them even after their death, as it happens practically.
And you see that gradually this means that the chanting is getting homogenized. It's getting more and more uniform. For example, if there were great differences between Constantinople and Athens in the beginnings of the 20th century, now this difference is becoming smaller and smaller. And I think that we have a very obvious example with the students of Angelopoulos that are now in Mount Athos, and they are making the chanting, the Psaltiki of Vatopedi, excuse me, closer and closer to the one of Angelopoulos. There is because of this, there is a subversion, there is a new relationship between the teacher and the pupil and the disciple. Because in early times, you could only have a teacher, a master. And if you wanted a second one, you had to travel to him and stay there. You could not live in Volos and follow lessons in Athos or in Athens or something like that. Today, there is plenty of choices. There we have people who study simultaneously in two or three different teachers. And finally, the new chanter has to fix his style, choosing, while in older times, there was no choice. He was bound by his tradition. He would follow his teacher. There was no different choice. This is, of course, a different approach. And today, I would dare to say that the teacher is not asked to give more ideas and more incentives, but to restrict the choices. I think it's very important, even if we think about what happens with folk music in 100 years ago or so, people who were doing folk music had no idea that we must keep it clear from in from epitrasis influences. Thank you. We incorporate whatever we want. Today, it's very clear when you deal with folk music, with traditional, that you have to keep it clear. So it's totally different approach to it. Next question, which is important, is the question of accuracy. Now with the recordings, we have exactly the hand on the nail marks, as Saint Tom wanted to do. We can listen exactly what Navpliotis used to chant, what Maneas used to chant, what exactly Stanitsas chanted, while in the modern times, it was the case that who was powerful enough could impose his opinion. Yesterday with Mr. Papas, we discussed what he told in the last conference of the Idrima for Byzantine Musicology, that many people claim to have the style of the Patriarchate, while many, very few of them really have it. So in the modern times, it was much easier to have to just say that it is like that and impose this opinion, while now it's much easier to be to prove, to check out that it really is or it is not. And because of this, we can have even this critique of discography, that the discography of the 20s or the 60s or the 30s, even the 60s, is not exactly with what was chanted in the church. I mean, if you listen, if an archaeologist find a vinyl record of the choir of the Panhellenios Synthesmos Hieropsalton of the Greek Chanters Association, if he would think that this thing that was on the record was heard on in the churches, he would be completely missing the point, yes. But what is important in this case, the biggest the accuracy becomes, there is less and less faith and creativity. Because in older times, what you could not find and listen to, you had to recreate it with your imagination and your faith. Well, now you have no such margin, because you know exactly it was like that. And because of this, practically, I think that both new chanters and as well as new agiographers, they have started to make exact copies.
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Wow, wow, wow. Like industry, when you see new church painters, they have no difference between them. As well, I have this feeling that we have the problem with the new Sanders, that they all of them try to sound either like the maestros, or like the Greek Byzantine choir of Agelopoulos. I mean, we have two models, and everybody tries to follow it, follow them as closer as he can. So I'm just passing the copyright, because in Psaltiki it's a very marginal question. If you want, in the break we can talk about. One very important question is this, and maybe I will stop here. Finally, can we say that we have one definite version of the music piece, as we have so many recordings of the same piece performed by different Santers, as it was the case in pre-modern era? There was many different small variants, and no one was the definite one. Because of the standardization of the modern technologies, of the printing industry especially, and then of the gramophone, we have this idea that we have to standardize, that this must be exactly this and nothing else. And this has been observed also in Western classical music, like Pandora Hopkins spoke about it very clearly in her article of 2000, that gradually in Western European music in late 19th century, the musical piece gradually gets identified as its score. And it's not the case in early times. In early times, the score was just a memorandum for the performer. And Stern also, who speaks about the invasion of recording technology, points out one more point, that the musical piece now is defined as what is heard, what is listened to, and not as what is performed. But especially in Psaltiki, these two can be very different, and you know it very well, as you have heard the recordings of Psaltiki outside of the church space, and it's not the same. Critical is the question, what is the role of the composer? Maybe in the tradition of Eastern Orthodox Church, in general, the creator is not pronounced in the way it is pronounced in the West. And it is very good that we found the creators and we focus on their work and what they have done. But we must keep in mind that these people, especially the older people, like the generation of Kukuzelis, for example, had different qualities and different values, like humility, like obedience. And that's why the older ones used to write that this piece is composed following the older ones, kata mimesin paleoteron, by as imitation of older creatures, and not as innovation. So I think I have to stop here, and if there are some points left off, you will read them in the proceedings. Thank you.